Net about 1,000, you think?
Yeah.
about that? Okay, good. And it was a lot of fun.
I think the red team won, though. We had a little competition going outside. We had red team and a blue team. And the blue team thinks they won, but they were doing the counting, so I'm not sure. I think
we're
accurate. I don't know. I noticed that you started at half and we had 14. So, but it was a lot of fun. We thank you all for all of your help on that, and look forward to other things coming up in the future. So if you are interested, one of those other things that's coming up is we're serving at Press House on the 20th. Now, I can take one more person in my car, so if somebody wants to go and doesn't want to drive up to Madison, I can take one more person in my car. But we are going to serve lasagna, salad, garlic bread, and desserts. There is a sign-up sheet out in the back. So the lasagna, it can be pre-baked, but it doesn't have to be warm because we'll put it in the oven when we get there. The garlic bread does not need to be pre-baked, just dropped off. Right now, there are three of us, my husband, my daughter, and I, who are going to serve at Press House. But we would love to have as many people who would like to come and serve. It's a lot of fun. It's on the 20th of May, or March, sorry, 20th of March. And we're looking for donations and anyone who would like to come and help serve. It is always a lot of fun. Are there other announcements that need to be made this morning? Okay. Linda, sorry.
We'll be planning our May baskets next Sunday after church at Fellowship Hall. So come to plant seeds or decorate the bell cartons. Hope to see you.
So we'll be doing our May baskets again. I think we're only going to do marigolds this year.
Yes.
So I got my little milk carton. The one was for a marigold. I planted it in our vegetable garden to keep the bugs away. By the time it was done, it was this wide and about this tall. So those marigolds did well. So if you'd like to help out next week, right after worship?
Yes.
Right after worship, we'll be decorating, planting. So dress casually if you want to help plant. That will be getting those together. And then on the 1st, May 1st, we'll be having you pick up your seeds or your pool plants and ask everybody to take a couple and deliver to neighbors and other friends who live nearby. Any other announcements? Our fish banks went out today with our children. So kids, y'all got your fish banks? So what I want you to do is this week, because we're talking about journey, being on a journey, I want you to count the number of shoes and boots you have in your house. Oh, I think, looking at Carly's face, I think Carly must really like shoes. So count the number of shoes and put a coin in. I don't care what kind of coin, but put a coin in for every pair of shoes. And if you have grown a pair of shoes that are still in good shape, consider donating those for someone else, you know, particularly snow boots and things like that. Donate those for someone else who might be able to use them. So that's our coins for this week. If we have no further announcements, then let us rise and prepare ourselves to worship God together. The season of Lent sets us on a journey.
The journey
begins in the wilderness. We follow the way of Jesus, who faced trials, trouble, temptation, and testing.
Like Jesus, we are not alone.
The Holy Spirit is with us. God's word is on our lips. Our call is to trust in God alone, to do God's will in all things. For God leads us not only into the wilderness, but also through the wilderness. Let us sing together number 166. Lord, throughout these 40 days.
Giving you, and you shall put it in a basket
and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us. When the priest takes the basket from your hands and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God. A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number. And there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor on us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction and our toil and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And our gospel reading this morning comes from the Gospel according to Luke. Listen once again for God's word to us. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during these days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread. Jesus answered him, it is written, one does not live by bread alone. Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, to you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours. Jesus answered him, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you and protect you. And on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Jesus answered him, it is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our Lord endures forever. So what do we take when we go into the wilderness? Well, probably the most important thing is good shoes and good socks. I mean, if we're going to be tramping through the wilderness, we need to make sure that we're prepared. A compass, food, water, a plan. But do we take the Holy Spirit with us into the wilderness? Because you see, when Jesus went into the wilderness, particularly in Luke's gospel, now Jesus goes into the wilderness in all three of the synoptic gospels. So the synoptic gospels are Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Now Mark doesn't give us much more than two lines. Jesus went into the wilderness, and he came back out in 40 days. Matthew and Luke give us a little bit more. The temptations are the same in a little bit of a different order, but what's unique in Luke's gospel, the gospel that we read today, is Jesus was not only led by the Holy Spirit to the wilderness and left there, but the Holy Spirit stays with Jesus throughout his time in the wilderness. It abides with Jesus throughout his time. So Jesus, though he doesn't have disciples with him, is not alone. And that's surprising. When Jesus is in a vulnerable place, the devil comes. Now, if we're thinking of the devil as kind of a guy in a red suit with a forked tail, you know, the picture from the devil ham package, it might not occur to us why this was such an attractive offer. But you see, the devil knows exactly what our weaknesses are and what's attractive. Jesus is starving. He's famished. And so the first thing that the devil tries to convince Jesus of is, well, if you're the Son of God, you could turn rocks into food. This shouldn't be hard. Why not? And that's probably the most attractive of all of the temptations for Jesus, because let's face it, if you're hungry, food sounds great. But Jesus quotes back to the devil's scripture. And so he tries another tact. How about power? How about proving who you are by an act of being saved by God's angels? How about any of those things? Because you see, when we're in the wilderness, the devil finds those things that are most tempting to us and offers them. And there's a temptation to feel like we can do it all alone. Yes, we can do this all by ourselves, and we don't need anyone else. And the Spirit is with Jesus. And so Jesus is able to persevere, to come not just to the wilderness, but through the wilderness. And the wilderness is a piece of our family stories in Scripture that has a hold of our imaginations. Because the people of Israel were first led out of Egypt into the wilderness to learn who they were and whose they were. And by the time we get to the reading in Deuteronomy, we've gotten through the Exodus, we've gotten through the laws of Leviticus. In Deuteronomy, by the time we get there, there's very good plan for the future. And so the instructions that they get from Moses are what they're supposed to do once they've gotten into the promised land. You see, God will no longer need to provide manna in the wilderness. They will be able to plant and reap their own harvest. But the first thing they bring are the first fruits, the best, those things that you've been waiting for. They're the first fruits as an offering. This is something that is ingrained in who we are as God's people. Whether we are Christian, Muslim, or Hindu. Because what was interesting is when we had a couple of folks over doing our gardening, we had two families who were working together. And what struck me is as soon as they picked something, they would hand it to me or one of the other members of the church and say, here's the first cucumber. Here's the first tomato. And this is our offering in thanksgiving for what the land has brought forth. It was a powerful thing. The session got to have some of those first fruits in our meal together when everything started to come in. because there was this offering of what's the best that we have and how do we share it with one another. So the wilderness is a place that we go to learn who we are and whose we are. But it's also a place of great anxiety and worry, because you know what? In the wilderness, we learn that where we were before is not going to be where we are as we come through. And that's always hard. Because you see, we would like sometimes to come through and go back to the way things were. Did you notice how often in the wilderness people of God would say, you know what? This manna is not what I expected. Could we go back and eat plenty in Egypt? When we're in the wilderness, sometimes we don't really want to go forward. We'd rather go back. But Jesus knows who he is and whose he is. And he also takes that anxiety and that worry and continues to think about the future. Because the future is different. And it's anxious. But it's only in embracing that discomfort that God is able to do an entirely new thing. And so Jesus comes through the wilderness, made new. Made new and ready to help his disciples and those who gather to embrace the newness that comes with being God's people. It's hard. It's frightening. In fact, I went through this process with a lot of churches, whether their pastors are retiring or leaving or whether they're changing the way things are going. And there's a lot of anxiety. And the first thing that I always hear is, okay, but what we want to do is go back to the way things were in the 1950s. You know, we used to have, our Sunday school classes used to be huge. We used to have 45 kids in confirmation. That's what we want. And we have to talk about what God might be doing now that's new. And both honoring the heritage and moving forward to where God dreams for us in the future. In our Sunday school class, the adult Sunday school class this morning, we were talking about vocation. Our vocation as Christians. And we came across this Frederick Buechner quote that I love. It's the place where our great joy meets the world's great need, that we're called to be as Christians, our Christian vocation. And it's only by going through the wilderness sometimes that we can come to the other side and recognize that. Recognize what is our great joy. And recognize the places where that great joy meets a great need. And that's where we're called to be in the world. And we know we don't have to go through it alone. Because the Holy Spirit, who led us into the wilderness, didn't leave us there, but leads us through and beyond into the new life that God has planned for us. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please rise and sing with me 40 days and 40 nights from the 167.
Thank you.
We have a lot of opportunities for generosity. We can give of our time. We can give of our talent. We can give of our treasure. And during this Lenten season, we take some special offerings up. Our mission focus during Lent is the Heifer Project. Now, some of you know some things about the Heifer Project, but what's amazing is it not only is an agricultural project to give animals and sustainability to a place, but also works with self-development people and things like that. So our mission focus during this month, and if you watch on Wednesdays, we'll tell you a little bit about more about what the Heifer Project does. Now I know for my youth, we had kind of hoped we might go to Triangle this year, and that got canceled. But the exciting thing is there is actually a Heifer Project camp down south where we can possibly go and learn about exactly how this project works. But I'm inviting all of you, as you get to mission this Lenten season, to keep the Heifer Project in mind. We also will be picking up our One Great Hour of Sharing. And our One Great Hour of Sharing is one of the special offerings that comes from the Presbyterian Church USA. This is probably the oldest of our offerings. But it helps three major areas. Presbyterian Disaster Assistance, which helps to do humanitarian aid and natural and man-made disasters. So the Presbyterian Disaster Assistance is the group that is working with you with Ukraine right now, with the tornadoes that hit last night in Iowa, with any of those other places. And it's also the group that works with self-development of people and Presbyterian hunger. So we'll be picking those that special offering up during Lent, finishing on Easter. So I invite you to give generously to that and to give generously of your time, talent, and treasure to find that place where your great joy meets the world's great hunger. Let us give thanks to God.
Up and running, and especially thankful to Bobby Burnett for her persistence in getting it done.
Isn't it wonderful to hear the organ? It's just, wonderful that it's fixed. Thank you, Bobby, for all of your persistence and many days here with the technicians.
It's a joy to play.
What else are we thankful for? Al.
A Taste of Spring.
It was wonderful. I'm thankful for getting together with everyone for the pancake supper. It was a lot of fun. Maybe because I wasn't making pancakes. I was just outside talking to people, which is great fun. But we had a great time. So I'm thankful for our finding a new way to share with our community. What else are we thankful for? We're thankful, Matt is here, even though he's in the midst of musical today. One more show?
Oh, no, that's not today. We have, next week is our show and the week after. Susical was last night, and that was fantastic. I would give thanks for that, for sure.
Yes. If you have not made it to Susical yet at the high school, 2 o'clock today, tickets are available. But boy, what joy, what fun. So after you see Sissical, if you want to see Sister Act, come see it, Lloyd. For all of these things, oh God, we are truly thankful. Amen. Scripture says, you shall not live by bread alone. So we spread the bread with the butter of compassion and the jam of welcome. Jesus said, you shall not live by bread alone. We serve this bread on plates of plenty, offered to the food insecure every day of the week. Every Lent we hear, you shall not live by bread alone. We invite all of God's children, the ones we know, the ones we don't know yet. Even when we feel alone, we are never alone. Together, in body and in spirit, we eat this bread and drink this cup. Let us remember the stories of our faith. We remember stories of wanderers, bringing first fruits in a basket, giving thanks for finding a home. And we give thanks for our kitchen tables and our precious sanctuary, both homes and places we share. We remember that Jesus Christ, sitting among those whose feet he had washed at the Passover table of precious and ancient tradition, anticipated betrayal and desertion, pain, even death, but made a new thanksgiving, a new hope, a way for peace, a new covenant, a blessed bread and poured wine on a global table, inviting us always to share from our brokenness and from our grace. Let us pray. O God, the sky speaks of your glory and deep space of your creation. Daybreak announces hope and starlight sings rest in a language that needs no translation, but closing our eyes in prayer. Nothing is hidden from you, and you make no barriers for human understanding. We are revived, enlightened, warmed, and comforted. Beyond even the bright and sweet parables of our lives, you free us from definitions of relationship based on dominion and being dominated. And you lead us to words of reconciliation and grace. So reconcile, we pray, let the bread of our mouths and the cup upon which our hearts meditate be acceptable to you, O God, at this ordinary table, and in our lives of redeeming. Amen. And we pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Lord Jesus, when the night was rest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat. This is my body given for you. Every time you eat this, do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, this cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink this, do this in remembrance of me. So every time that we eat this bread, and we drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for all of the people of God. Thanks be to God. And I will dismiss you by those to come up and get your communion elements, and then we'll invite you to come back to your seat to take them. So,
come get them and take them back.
Unto the table, Lord, you go.
Thank you, gracious God, for giving us bread for the journey of these 40 days. As we travel on through the wilderness, help us to share your grace with others and draw us ever closer to you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We will sing together, "What Wondrous Love Is This?" number 215.
There.